In the 1980s, there's one thing many home computers had in common, which you don't see anymore, and that is the computer was built into the keyboard. This included popular machines such as the Commodore 64, the Apple IIc, the Atari 800XL, and the Sinclair Spectrum. But this design fell out of favor by the early 90s. The last popular computer to have this style was the Amiga 1200, which was in production until 1996. Nowadays, you can find plenty of so-called all-in-one computers, but almost without exception, that means the computer is built into the monitor rather than into the keyboard. One of the few companies that has kept making keyboard PCs is Cybernet, with what they call zero-footprint PCs, although their computers are mostly aimed towards hospitals and businesses, and not towards consumers. But recently, I came across a small keyboard PC that bore an uncanny resemblance to the Sinclair Spectrum. I found it on an Australian website, and it had no brand name or model number. It just said Windows 10 Compact Computer. So after a lot of searching, I found out that this computer is best known as the K3 Wintel Keyboard PC. And you can find these on eBay and several other places. But I found the best price on a website called Geek Buying. They're selling it for $99 with free shipping from China. And for that price, you get an Intel Bay Trail 64-bit processor, 2 gigs of RAM, 32 gigs of an internal flash memory storage, a micro SD card slot which can accept to a 64 gigabyte card, built-in wireless and Bluetooth, and various other ports I'll go over later. And it comes with Windows 10 Home Edition pre-installed. And someone actually took one of these apart, and I'll link to that article so you can see photos and details of the insides of this machine. But I decided to get one for myself to see what kind of computer you can get for $99 these days, and to see whether or not it's worth buying the K3 Wintel PC. Comes in just a plain cardboard box. There's a sticker on the side here. It says K3 Keyboard Mini PC, and then it gives some of the specs. Same sticker on this side, and it has a stamp here saying May 6th, 2016. And if that's the production date, then they get these things out the door lickety-split, because that's the same date they mailed it to me. It probably came directly from the factory. Here's the address that was on the package. I'm not going to even attempt to pronounce that, but it's in Shenzhen, China. Even has their phone number there in case anybody wants to call them. Opening up the box, the first thing we see is the little manual, or quick start guide as they say. Windows 10 Intel tablet PC. It's not a tablet, it's just a keyboard PC, so even they're a little confused about what they are. Lenovo is glad to provide computer products with Windows 10 pre-installed. Well, as far as I know, this is not a Lenovo. Thank you for choosing the Intel Keyboard 1. So on and so forth. What is OOBE? Leave a comment if you know what OOBE means without looking it up. There's a little bit about the machine here. Video output spelled wrong. Ethernet RJ45 support 100 trillion. That must be the world's fastest network. And here, as typical, they use TF to mean a micro SD card, because TransFlash was a code name for that format, and somehow the Chinese stuck onto that, and they keep calling it TF, even though the rest of the world calls it micro SD. So there you see the keyboard computer itself, and under here is the power supply, 5 volts, 3 amps, and only other thing in the box is the computer itself. There's nothing else in there. So there is the computer itself. The keys are actually better than I expected. They're fairly similar to an Apple-style chiclet keyboard. So not exactly the most tactile typing experience, but it's pretty decent for what it is. It has these tiny little arrow keys on this side, and a little touchpad here, which crowds out these keys here, which looks rather awkward. And if you want to use dedicated mouse buttons, I think you have to hold down function and then hit one of these two buttons. And you can see the function keys are secondary except for F1. So F1 you can hit by itself, but anything above that you have to hold down the function key to access F2 through F12. And the primary functions are the shortcut keys. That's the right click menu button, which is normally down here somewhere on a regular keyboard. Then you get some media player controls, volume controls, mute, and delete all by itself. I don't know if this thing even has an insert key. It doesn't look like it. And there's also no print screen button. And the only lock key we get is caps lock. There's no num lock or scroll lock. So it's not a full PC keyboard. You do miss out on some of the functions, but it's pretty much what you expect for a keyboard of this size. They had to cut some corners to get it to fit and have reasonably sized keys for the main letter and number keys. You also get some LEDs here for sleep, lock, which I assume is caps lock, and power. And there is a tiny built-in microphone. This does not have any microphone jack. It's only an earphone output. So if you want to record some audio, your only choice is the built-in microphone. So looking at the back, we get a power button, headphone output, VGA monitor output, Ethernet, two USB ports, a reset hole, which you can stick in a straightened out paperclip, which is unusual to see these days. HDMI output, DC power input, and there's the little micro SD card, or what they call a TF card slot. On the bottom, you get these little rubber feet and some cooling vents. There is no fan in this thing, obviously, and nothing on the sides. So it literally is the size of a little tablet keyboard, except it's an entire computer. So here it is set up, and you wouldn't even know that's the entire computer in the keyboard, except for the extra cable sticking out of the back. If you hammer the escape or delete key while starting it up, you'll get into the BIOS setup, which is American Megatrend's BIOS. Shows there the 2 gigs of RAM, and there we see CPU speed, 1.33 gigahertz, 64-bit supported. And there's a lot of settings in here. It really lets you set up all the specific details of how the hardware works. Far beyond even what I can understand here. So I would recommend not messing around with these settings unless you really know what you're doing. And you can turn off secure boot, although I was not able to use a bootable USB flash drive containing Ubuntu. It wouldn't start up. It would only start up a flash drive containing Windows 10. So maybe there's more tweaking needed here to get this to work. But in the meantime, I'll just exit out of this and start it up in Windows 10. Comes pre-installed and pre-configured with Windows 10 Home Edition, with an account called admin with no password, so you obviously should change that. So here it is in Windows 10. I've already customized the background and the color scheme to my liking, and I also installed Classic Shell so I can get a regular start menu. But if you hold down the Shift key, you can get the Windows 10 start menu here. Here are the system properties, Windows 10 Home Edition. There it shows Intel Atom Z3735F at 1.33 gigahertz, 2 gigs of RAM. It's a 32-bit operating system. Because of only 2 gigs of RAM, the benefit of a 64-bit operating system really isn't that much, so it doesn't really make that much of a difference. And it is activated, so it appears to be a legitimate copy of Windows 10. And on our C drive, out of the 32 gig drive, we have only about 11 gigs free, which is a little surprising. I thought it'd be a little bit more free space than that, since it doesn't really appear to have anything more than what Windows normally comes with. It is connected to my wireless, and it also shows Bluetooth here, even though I don't have anything Bluetooth set up. One thing a little surprising, this thing doesn't have any built-in speaker, not even a little piezo beeper. So in order to hear anything, you have to connect external speakers. Here's Internet Explorer, which still works. I definitely prefer it over Microsoft Edge. So I think only just now they're beginning to support add-ons in Edge, such as ad blockers. Seems to do just fine online. Don't you love how Google is constantly shoving Google Chrome in our face? It says watch YouTube videos of Chrome. Well, you can watch them just fine in Internet Explorer, so that's what I'm gonna do. I don't have any speakers hooked up yet, but the video should play fine as it is. Let's go full screen here. And here it is playing in 720p. Looks perfectly smooth, so, and seems to be working just fine. So here is Microsoft Edge, and the one thing I like about it is you can choose either a light theme or a dark theme. So for web browsing, this computer is perfectly fine. Obviously, it's not really meant for gaming, but for general purpose computing tasks, gets the job done. Can't complain for $99. I did have to do the Windows Fall 2015 update to bring it up to version 1511, which took a couple hours to download and install, so it's a pretty major update, and it fixed quite a few bugs and added some new features, including the ability to change the color of the window title bars, which is something the first version of Windows 10 did not have. So I'm still not really a fan of Windows 10. I think it still needs a lot of improvement. It's still obviously designed for a touchscreen, even though most people are going to be using a mouse and a keyboard. For example, if you want to change your date and time, why is this cut off right here at the bottom of this window when it has all this room on the screen to continue? That's just stupid design there. I know they're trying to make these big enough so you can touch it with your finger, but they have all this room on the screen, they could have extended it. So it's just stupid little things like that. But otherwise, I could get along okay with it, especially with the classic shell installed. It's acceptable, which is about the best I can say about it right now. I wouldn't go out of my way to put Windows 10 on a computer that's currently running Windows 7, but for this computer that comes with Windows 10, I wouldn't bother changing it to anything else. And if you're concerned about Windows 10 spying on you, there's a free program you can get called SpyBot Anti-Beacon. All you have to do is just install it and then click on Immunize. Then it blocks all the telemetry that Microsoft does to keep track of what's going on your computer. And there's additional options here you can choose to block or not. So that takes care of it very quickly.
Are you ready for this? Explosion test! Well, it didn't blow up.
Today on Linus Car Tips, we're going to be unboxing the Nissan GT-R. This is a fully sporty vehicle that I can definitely fit inside and drive.
The famous master making guitars are Nicola Amati, Nicholas Marty. What? If you're going to anglicise names, you have to be able to speak English. That's really important. Antonio Stradivari, Antonio Stella Bottom.
That was some video playback with a direct hookup to the audio, just to give you a sample of what it looks and sounds like. It's not much else to show. In Windows 10, it pretty much acts like any other computer with Windows 10 and similar specs. So I'm just going to shut it down here and close out the review. And yes, Windows 10 does support a floppy drive. I just plugged this in and it started working right away. There are the files on the disk. So that's working fine. And as for this little touchpad here, it's actually not too bad. It's obviously very small, but it's usable. I can get around okay and tap on things to click on them. So I wouldn't exactly want to use this touchpad permanently with this computer, but it's okay. It's good enough to get you started. Or if you're using this computer in a very tight space that you don't even have room for an external mouse, it'll get you by okay. And these two keys do work as the mouse buttons, and you do have to hold down the function key to use them. So for example, if I hold down function and hit control, that's the left mouse button, and if I hold down function and hit the Windows key, that's the right mouse button. And you may have noticed there's no print screen key, but in my research I found that if you hold down Alt and hit F2, that acts as a print screen. So that just captured an image of the desktop. So if I go into Paint and paste it, we have our image of our desktop that we can save here as a screenshot. So that's my review of the K3 Wintel Keyboard Windows 10 Mini PC. Available for $99.99. Obviously it's not going to suit everybody's needs, but it's an interesting device. Certainly a unique form factor. may have its uses, and it certainly brings back memories of the home computers of the 1980s.